Thank you, Susan. I'm going to try and use this thing, although I may not need it. And if I put it down, it'll be because I only have two hands and I've got these cards to help me remember what to talk about. And so if I put it down, I'll just talk louder. I want to thank Al Pierce Company for sponsoring this series. I want to thank Susan for all the cooperation and help she has been in getting things together. And I want to thank particularly Steve Grive, who can't be here tonight because he has other things to do, but he loaned me the slides I'm going to use. There are only going to be four, but they're really important and interesting. And he gave me tips on how to operate the system here, so hopefully when I punch the button, the next slide appears. It doesn't, but that'll be my doing. World War II got its seeds out of the end of World War I. That war didn't end with really a concession or a surrender. It ended with an armistice. And for a long time, we celebrated Armistice Day on November 11th. Now we have Veterans Day on that day. But after that war, it was pretty obvious that the Allied forces, the French, British, and Americans, with some other countries, had pretty much put Germany in a position where it couldn't continue. And so Germany stopped fighting and they had this armistice, but the Allied forces exacted a pretty stiff toll on the Germans. They made them give up parts of their country, the Ruhr, they forbade them from bringing troops into the Rhineland, they took away the part of what had been East Prussia, where Danzig was, and gave that to the Polish. They required the Germans to pay extremely heavy reparations to pay back what the Allied countries had spent defending themselves against what they regarded as an unjust war. At the end of World War II, there was a corporal in the German army whose first name was Adolf, and I think you all probably know his last name was Hitler. And he was among the many, many troops who were unhappy with what happened at the end of World War I. And he became involved in politics, not expecting ever to go anywhere. He just wanted to join this National Socialist German Workers' Party, which he did. And then he began making speeches and discovered that he had a real flair for making speeches and that people would listen and, to some extent, heed what he said. And he got a band of guys around him who they called the Brown Shirts. They were basically thugs that would go around and beat people up and said things contrary to what Mr. Hitler was saying. And in 1923, an event occurred that came to be known as the Beer Hall Putsch. The Putsch is a rising, a struggle. And this happened in Munich, and Hitler and about 2,000 others were marching down the streets of Munich, and the police got out in front of them and tried to stop this. And there were some shots fired, and several of Hitler's supporters were killed, others wounded, and four policemen were shot as a result of this. The net result was that Hitler ended up in a prison, I think it was Landsberg Prison, but wherever it was in Germany. And while there, he wrote his first book called Mein Kampf, which translates as My Struggle. And in it, Hitler basically laid out how he would run things if he ever became in power. And he had many, many unkind things to say about Jewish people. He thought that Germany needed more Lebensraum, living room, and that they should expand their borders and take over neighboring countries. And he got out of prison after a fairly short stay of about 2 years, and then he began campaigning for the Nazi party, the National Socialist German Workers' Party, just to get people into their legislature, and he was fairly successful at that. And pretty soon he got some votes for various other offices and rose in the party, became its leader. And then they kept having elections on a regular basis to select new members for their legislature. And in one of them, the Nazis got enough votes that they and one other party were able to take over. And it wasn't very long after that, it was March of 1933, when I was 2 months old, that Hitler became the Chancellor of Germany. And things began to happen very quickly after that. Jewish people started suffering, the Tufts, the Brown Shirts, and other Nazi-affiliated groups would go to their stores and break them, and they had one night they called Kristallnacht. Kristallnacht was when these thugs basically broke everything in all the Jewish stores, and a lot of the glass was all over on the sidewalk, and that was what led to Kristallnacht. And then Hitler started making his territorial moves, and the first thing he did was use threats of force to take over Austria. Now, Austria was very dear to his heart because he was born in Austria, and when he started running for political office, he found that he couldn't do it because he was not a German citizen. He was an Austrian citizen, but he got that corrected and became a German citizen. And first they took over, and I'm going to switch now and go to a slide. I'm going to use these intermittently. One of the places that he took over was called the Sudetenland, which is the western fringe of Czechoslovakia. And a lot of German people lived in the Sudetenland, and Hitler made the claim that this was really German property and that these Germans should not be excluded from being a part of the Reich, the German country. And they had a big confrontation in Munich between Hitler and Neville Chamberlain, who was the Prime Minister of England, and I think the Frenchman's name was Daladier. Anyway, he basically cowed them enough that they agreed, the two, the British and the French, that Hitler could take over the Sudetenland, that he would make no more territorial demands in Europe, he said. Well, that was a bald-faced lie. He was already planning the next moves. And the next move was to take over most of the rest of Czechoslovakia. He had already gotten Austria to join the German Reich in 1938. And then he began planning to get even with Poland for taking part of Germany at the end of World War I. And he started by making a deal with Stalin and the Russians to draw a line down Poland where they pretty much divided up Poland between them, even though Poland didn't know they were being divided up, nor did anyone. And that was in August of 1939, and within a month, Hitler faked an attack, had a bunch of German troops and some prisoners dressed up as in Polish military uniforms and attacked a German radio station somewhere, if I can get this thing to work, there they are, somewhere right in that area there. And Germany then responded by launching the first Blitzkrieg. Blitzkrieg means lightning war. And the Germans had perfected that. They had a general named Guderian, who was extremely good at tactics and military tactics, and he devised this method of having dive bombers come overhead, tanks and armored cars on the ground, and many, many troops, but a lot of force, way more than had been seen in previous wars. They didn't have mobile troops like that that could be moved around very rapidly from place to place, but Hitler did have, and he just dropped the Poles and went up to his part of the line there in Poland and stopped. And then we had the Sitzkrieg. The Sitzkrieg was the alternative to the Blitzkrieg. The Blitzkrieg was lightning war. The Sitzkrieg, the French didn't do anything. The British didn't do anything. Nobody did anything. They were allies in Poland. They declared war on Germany when Germany invaded Poland, but they didn't do anything. So Hitler, they sat there in that state of affairs until May of 1940. And then Hitler's forces came through here, all through here, into France, and sent another group down here behind the German and French lines and jammed them all into a little place called Dunkirk. And most of you have heard of Dunkirk. If you haven't, that is where the British had about 350,000 troops there. The French had a bunch. And they wanted to get them out of there because it was obvious the Germans were going to take them prisoner. And so the British had a whole bunch of little tiny vessels and some bigger ones that went from southern England over to Dunkirk and picked up these soldiers. They couldn't get their weapons for the most part because they didn't have room, but they picked up all these soldiers and took them back to England, and they saved over 300,000 troops by doing that. And then nothing much happened for quite a while after that until June of 41. When Hitler, having made this pretty face with Russia, decided that that was a good place to get more Lebensraum. So, on June 22nd of 1941, Hitler attacked Russia up to Leningrad, over to Moscow, and over toward central Russia, north of Stalingrad. They also had a branch that went down here to the Black Sea. And they were very successful all through the summer and into the fall. But then what the Russians called General Winter came on. And the Germans weren't properly prepared for doing battle with General Winter. It was extremely cold. They didn't have cold weather clothes. Their vehicles all froze up. They wouldn't move. And the Russians were more prepared, and they were able to stop the Germans at that point and back them off. The next thing that happened in the war involves the United States of America. And this is a map of the Pacific. And that right there is where the Hawaiian Islands are and Pearl Harbor is and was then. And on December 7th of 1941, almost 76 years ago, 2 days from now it'll be 76 years, this fleet of Japanese carriers sat right over there and sent carrier planes, bombers, torpedo planes, fighter planes, down to Pearl Harbor without any warning. The Americans were not prepared for this. They didn't know it was coming, and all of a sudden here are these many, many planes of all kinds with those red balls on the wings, and they were sending torpedoes into U.S. battleships and cruisers, bombing air bases, bombing all kinds of facilities, bombing other ships. And they did a very good job of wiping out a good bit of the U.S. Pacific Fleet. The lucky thing for the United States was that their carriers weren't there. And it quickly became obvious as the war went on, really was obvious that morning, that the one who had the most and best carriers and carrier planes was going to win the battles. Didn't make any difference if you had giant dreadnought battleships. If they were 300 miles away and this opponent was sending planes with torpedoes and bombs, but we were lucky. We didn't have any carriers lost. And then the Japanese followed that the very next day with an attack on the Philippines, where we had a bunch of troops. General MacArthur was there. And General MacArthur and his chief of staff refused to let the Army Air Corps, there was no Air Force, that was the Army Air Corps, refused to let them take their planes off and move them to a more distant airfield. And the Japanese came over and just blew up all the planes. They're just sitting there lined up on the runway. And that was not a good thing. And General MacArthur got a lot of credit for a bunch of things that somebody else did. I've read a lot about him. I've got books about him. I really don't think he was a very good general. But anyway, and then the Japanese conquered the Philippines, and they came across and took Wake Island. They took Guam. They took other islands that were U.S. protectorates, and they couldn't be stopped. And then they decided that they were going to invade the southern coast of Papua, which is a part of the island of New Guinea. It was right here, Port Moresby. And so they brought their two carriers. They had two of them. They thought that would be plenty in their nature, the Shokaku and the Zuikaku, and they sent them down here into the Coral Sea, expecting there might be some U.S. vessels there, and there were a couple they didn't know about, including the carrier Lexington and the carrier Yorktown. And they had this giant sea battle where none of the ships ever saw any other ship, any enemy ship. It was all the planes taking off the carriers and attacking the Japanese fleet, and the Japanese planes taking off their carriers and attacking our fleet. And that made it even more obvious that you didn't make any difference how many battleships. You wanted the carriers and carrier planes. And the net result of that was that the U.S. carrier Lexington got sunk and the Yorktown got badly damaged. And the Zuikaku and the Zuikaku suffered damage to the point where they had to go back to Japan and have a lot of work done on them. Well, that was kind of important because the next step the Japanese were going to take and did take was to attack the island of Midway. And you can see why they would really like to have that, because it's not too far from Hawaii, about 1,500 miles. And the Allies were able to figure out that that was where they were going. They had broken the Japanese naval code, and they kept talking about their pending attack on a place called AF. And the Allies didn't know where AF was. But they thought it was probably Midway, so they told the commander at Midway secretly to send a message to them in clear saying that they were running out of water. And so he did that. He sent a message, "We're in the short of water here." And sure enough, the Japanese send out their telegrams to their sources and say, AF is running out of water. Well, then they knew that AF was Midway. The admiral who was the commander of our remaining aircraft carriers, which were the Hornet and another one, I can't remember its name right now. Anyway, he got a skin disease, just itched and couldn't do anything, so they put a cruiser admiral in charge of the U.S. carrier fleet. And they sent them out over here, northeast of Midway, about 300 miles off Midway. And the Japanese were coming with this immense fleet of battleships and cruisers and four carriers to take over Midway. And the U.S. knew they were coming, but the Japanese didn't know the Americans were there. But they sent out scout planes from their carriers. They had four carriers. They had the Kaga, the Yukagi, the Soryu, and the Hiryu. And they were major fleet carriers. They were big. They carried 75 planes each. And they sent out these scout planes. Well, the one that was supposed to cover this area right here had trouble and had to go back and land. So they didn't search that area, and that was where the American plane ships were. So the Japanese were bombing Midway. Midway, my favorite battle, by the way, it made the difference in the Pacific War. They're bombing Midway and trying to get ready to invade and troop ships and so on. And the Allies, the Americans, send out their torpedo planes. Now, their torpedo planes were a thing called the Douglas Devastator. And a less devastating plane was never made. The Devastator was a worthless piece of junk. It would barely go 200 miles an hour at a time when most planes were flying 300 miles an hour. It wasn't maneuverable. It wasn't fast. And it didn't work very well. And so they sent in the torpedo planes, who got there first, and they came in flying down along to launch their torpedoes at the Japanese fleet, and they all got shot down because the Japanese had a whole bunch of Zero fighters. Zero fighter was a wonderful plane, better than anything we had or anybody else had at that time. And the Zeros came down and shot down all the Devastators except one. It got back badly wounded, but it did get back. And so about the time they were down shooting down all these Devastators, Douglas made another plane too, called the Douglas Dauntless. And that was a good plane. It was a dive bomber. And about that time when they were shooting down all these planes down here, here come the dive bombers up here, and they see one, two, three Japanese carriers. The fourth one was off to the side. And down they go, boom, 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 boom. Well, fortunately for the Americans, at that time, the Japanese had been switching from fragmentation bombs to attack Midway. Now they knew there were carriers around, so they were putting in torpedoes and armor-piercing bombs. And they had all this ordnance all over the decks. And when the dive bombers came down, their bombs hit the plane, hit the carrier, boom, everything goes out, you know, and they catch fire, same, one after another. And they then got the fourth one. So the Japanese, four biggest Japanese carriers, all were sunk in the Battle of Midway. And after that, things went the other way. We invaded Guadalcanal, which nobody had ever heard of before that. Guadalcanal is way down here. And the Japanese were getting ready to build an air base there so they could attack ships coming from the U.S. over to Australia. And the Americans really did not want that to happen, so they sent a whole bunch of Marines in, and they had a giant battle that lasted for about, well, from August of 42 to February of 43. But the Americans kept winning the battles, and the Japanese had to bring their troops in from a long ways away, and we already had our troops there. And the net result was that we drove the Japanese out of Guadalcanal, and then we hopscotched up this island chain here, the Solomon Islands, places like Bougainville and New Georgia and things like that. And then we went into New Guinea and started driving the Japanese out of that and continued on. Now, you wanted to know, this talk was supposed to be a little bit about what was happening in Coos Bay, Oregon. And so, what was going on? The day after Pearl Harbor, my wife Terry's dad went down and enlisted in the Navy. And many other people did the same thing. On December 8th, a Monday, they're down enlisting in the military service. Terry was then 3 years old, and her dad was in there until late 1945, and as she has said many times, he missed my cutest years. My father was too old to go into the military. He was 43, and he had four children, and he didn't go and didn't even consider it, but all of his brothers served, and I had seven of my uncles were in the military service during World War II. None of them got badly hurt, and none of them got killed. But that was what happened there. Here, an early event was that Army units began to arrive, and they built bunkers out between what's the park where everybody goes?
Shore Acres
and Cape Arago. And if you, back in the days when you could get up the little trails and roads and then up there, there were these bunkers bigger than this room where they had shore events cannon to shoot the Japanese when they came in. That was the reason those were there, and there were all these Army troops there. And then there were a couple of groups of Navy people, and I never knew just what they did. My brothers and I encountered these people more than most of the citizens because they played baseball right down at Mingus Park, softball. And we were the bad boys for all of these teams. And every game they would give us a bat or a ball, or if some guy was being transferred, he would give us his mitt. And by the time the war was over, we had 13 baseball mitts and more bats than all of them could leave. And we got to know these soldiers. There was one I particularly remember named Bushilaki. And he was a shortstop, and he was from Brooklyn. And he was a fun guy. We liked him a lot. We had USO units here, United Service Organization, to help the troops, provide them with a place to go at night, things like that. And we began to observe that whereas in the late 30s and even into the 1940, we would have CCC boys, Civilian Conservation Corps boys, sitting in three pews in our church. And then not long after the war started, they were all gone. They were going in the military. And they began to be replaced by three pews of Navy and Army and other people. So it was interesting to see that happen. Here in Coos Bay, North Bend, we had a blackout, which meant that you couldn't have any light shining out of your house. And if you wanted, you could have a shade. And we had these dark green shades at our house. I suppose there were other colors, black or maybe dark brown. But they had to be dark enough that the light wouldn't shine out. And we couldn't figure out why we had to do that, because we were on the downside of this big hill right below the rock wall up here, is where we lived. And why did they care? And later I read about what was happening on the eastern seaboard, where merchants and nightclubs in places from Florida clear up to New York, they had all their lights on, and even though you couldn't see them, you could see the aura, and the ships would be going by, and the German submarines sitting out beyond them, and they'd silhouette these ships, and that was happening here, and we had ships that were torpedoed off the Oregon coast. I don't think any right near here, because they could see them at night silhouetted against this glow that the town was putting out. You had to have your car lights covered with black tape and a little sliver that you could see through. My mother was a block warden, as were many other housewives and elderly people. And among the duties of the block warden was to go around everyone's house and be sure they had their buckets of sand. You had to have sand because it was believed that if the Japanese attacked us, they would drop incendiary bombs, which would fall, and you can't put an incendiary bomb out with water, it makes it worse. You had to throw sand on it. So everybody had to have a couple buckets of sand. And I never will forget the night that my brothers and I were playing upstairs in the bedroom and throwing toys at each other and things, and all of a sudden the pounding on the door, and it's the block warden from the next block up here, and he really read my mother the right eye. You should know better. You're a block warden. There are boys up there who've got the lights on. And oh my God, we forgot to put down the shade. My mother was so embarrassed by that. And then we started seeing these strange planes fly in and over. And they were much bigger than the little Piper Clubs and Taylor craft we used to see fly around at roughly 85 to 100 miles an hour. These things were going 300 miles an hour. They were zooming all over. And so we got out our books and saw that they were Grumman Wildcats, carrier fighting planes. And they were not too long after followed by bigger planes that didn't fly quite as fast, but were bigger. And those were Grumman Avengers torpedo planes and bombers, but they were primarily torpedo planes. And they were shooting landings over here, and this was where they initially trained guys to be carrier pilots, because we had a lot of wind that they could fly into, and that emulated the way it would be coming into a carrier flying, going against the wind. So, and some of those poor guys died out on the dunes. It didn't make it. There was one plane, a Grumman Avenger, which had three crewmen in it, and the guy was kind of showing off for his mother over in Coquille, and his plane went down and took out most of the block just northwest of the courthouse. The Grumman Wildcats were replaced by Grumman Hellcats, which I'm going to see how I'm doing here. I've got the time. The Grumman Hellcat was designed to beat the Zero, and it could. And they captured a Zero up at Kodiak, and then tested it, and built a plane that would fly, turn inside it, fly faster, be just as maneuverable. Meanwhile, here we were having rubber drives. We would take all our little rubber toys and put them in a box, and an old tire and pieces of the hose and stuff, and take them down to, we tried to take them to Commercial Auto Service, which was the second, and commercial, and nothing's been there for a long time, it's an empty lot. And the guy was really rude. He says, "You get out of here. I don't want any of that damn stuff. Take it out to Lou Blank." Well, we didn't even know what or where Lou Blank was, but we asked around and found that it was down where Wright's Home Furnishings now. There was a tire store there, and we went into Lou Blank's. Meanwhile, my mother was, we had a metal drive in addition to the rubber drive. We took coat hangers and toys and all kinds of metal down and sold it for a penny a pound. Everybody was saving cooking fat, and you'd have your little can and pour your fat and the grease out of your cooking if you made bacon, which was very hard to come by, but if you could get it and make bacon, right, then you'd save the grease, take it down and turn it in somewhere, and they used that somehow to help make munitions. Everything was rationed that you wanted. Among them were gasoline, tires, meat, butter, coffee, sugar, and heating fuel. Those were all rationed and many other things. And you would get points and a little set of ration stamps. You buy a pound of meat, or you'd have to turn in 44 ration stamps, and you've got 192 per person per week, I believe it was, and didn't go very far. And other things were hard to find, cars and tires among them. They weren't necessarily rations, there just weren't any being made. They're making jeeps and tanks and armored cars and things like that. And so there were no cars. You could, there might have been some 42 cars that came out in late 41, but none made 43 or 4 or 5, I don't think. And other hard to find things that weren't rationed were liquor, soap, Kleenex, I don't know if they call it Kleenex, but that kind of thing, diapers, cigarettes, soups, canned juices, and most important of all, there were no nylon stockings. There were no bicycles. I got a bicycle when I was 11 years old. It was a used bicycle that belonged to a guy who went to service. He was a big guy, not a little tiny guy. My feet wouldn't reach the pedals. But anyway, I made it go and it worked. And in the Pacific, now I've talked about what happened in 42. And I've talked about late 42 in Guadalcanal. We didn't do very well in the sea battle near Guadalcanal. Here it is down here, just north of it. There's a little dot right there, it's called Savo Island. And they had the Battle of Savo Island, where U.S. cruisers and I think a battleship were sailing around there, and Japanese cruisers were coming down the slot here, right there. And they had much better night fighting equipment than the U.S. Navy did at that point in the war. And they torpedoed about 5 of the U.S. cruisers, and several of them sank. So we were still, at that point, doing very well. Meanwhile, in Europe, as I showed you this previous slide here, the Germans were making great hay going this way. They got clear out to here, and actually got over to Stalingrad, right there, by about November of 1942. And then they started, their lines of supply were very long. They're way back here in Germany, and they're bringing all their equipment, gear, and whatever they need, food, clothing, all that distance. And the Russians are here, and their manufacturing facilities are right in here. So they didn't have near as far to go with the things they needed to fight the war as the Germans did. And it all settled into a major battle at Stalingrad. And in November of 1942, the Russians started encircling this German army of 600,000 troops around Stalingrad. And pretty soon they had them completely enclosed, and then they started moving in on them. And the Germans hadn't really seen that one coming. And they were normally very good generals, but they somehow missed that was happening, and the Russians encircled an army, the 6th Army, German 6th Army, commanded by a very good general named Paulus. And Hitler told Paulus to break out. Well, he tried to break out, and he couldn't get out. And then he sent other troops to break in and help them out, and they couldn't get through the Russian troops either. And from that time on, the war started going the other way in Europe, as well as it had been going a little earlier in the Pacific Theater. And so here come, this is the same thing, there's Stalingrad, Moscow, this is Russia here, and they're coming this way now, heading for Germany, and Romania, which was an ally of Germany, as was Finland. The Germans had captured Norway, in the before invading France, they conquered France, and Italy had joined the war as a German ally. And at the same time this Battle of Stalingrad was going on, two other things happened in North Africa. The Americans and British attacked Morocco and Algeria, and they're their lines of troops. And the British finally found a general who could stand up to Winston Churchill, and Churchill would send in a new general to command that troops, British troops in Egypt, there, and German troops here. There's this place called El Alamein, which was a little village, but it was the point where they were banging heads against each other. And Burgoyne Montgomery was the general for the British at that time in 1942, and Churchill was badgering him. He was always butting his nose in. He was a great man. We were lucky to have he and Franklin Roosevelt as the leaders of our two countries, because they made sure that things happened in a way that we won the war. But and he kept badgering Montgomery to attack, and finally Montgomery said, okay, I'm ready, and here we go. And he attacked the Germans and rather quickly drove them back out of Libya and up into Tunisia. And meanwhile, the Americans and British are coming this way, and they met in Tunisia and drove the Germans out. The Germans went over to Sicily. The Americans and British landed there, drove the Germans out of Sicily. They attacked them in Italy and started fighting their way up Italy. And about that same time, they were getting ready to attack France. And Roosevelt had been wanting to attack France in 43. Churchill said, we're not ready yet, it's too soon. And I think he may have been right about that, because when they did attack, finally, in June 6th of 1944, D-Day, and the Americans made a go at the British, and there were five beaches along here. There was Utah, Omaha, Gold Sword, and Juneau. Gold Sword and Juneau were British beaches. Utah and Omaha were American beaches. And they had all attacked with a vast number of vessels. Somebody said there were 6,000 vessels. That would include landing craft and things. Many, many, and we were really ready to make that battle go, and did. And we landed our troops on those beaches. They got stuck there fighting, but finally they broke out and took off across France like that, and everything was going really well through 1944 until December, when Hitler, largely him, had succeeded in convincing his generals to assemble a whole lot of troops right here in southern Belgium, and there they had the Battle of the Bulge right there. And that was we didn't do very well in that for the first 10 or 14 days. There was a village, actually a fair-sized town, right about there called Bastogne. And there was a general in charge of it for the Allies named McCulloch. And the Germans surrounded them, the whole city, and sent these four guys with a white flag in to make truce, and told the General McCall, if we have you surrounded, either you surrender or we will come in and kill every one of your troops. And McCall said, tell him, nuts. Nuts? Nuts. That was the whole reply. So here the German general gets his thing back with his big flowery demand, and the answer is nuts, and he didn't know what that meant. Anyway, about that same time, General Patton, who was a very good tactical general, he was good at winning battles. He wouldn't have been good to win a war, but he was sure good at winning battles. He was down here with his troops, and they had a meeting in Paris that he attended, and Montgomery attended, and all of them. They were wondering what to do about this bulge. And it was a bulge coming our way. And Patton said, well, I'll just switch my army and we'll go north and wipe them out. But you can't do that. Your troops are all facing east. They're not ready to go north. We will. And then he turned them all around, and they go north, and they just go tearing right through the Germans and get to Bastogne and relieve it. And I don't know, I always had a lot of respect for General Patton. He did some very crude things during the war, and most people didn't like him, and they called him old blood and guts. And it was said that the soldiers would say, yeah, our blood, his guts, you know. But anyway, I still got a little bit of time here. So, from the time of Stalingrad and North Africa, here and there, the Germans were on the defensive. And the Allies invaded there on D-Day and went across France. They also had an invasion later in 1944 here and went out that way and backed the Germans back into Germany. And that kept going, and the Russians, I won't say they were allowed, they may have gotten to Berlin first, but they made a deal that the Russians would conquer Berlin. And so they went in, and that turned out to be a mistake, because then after the war, they didn't want to give it up, and wouldn't let anybody in there, that sort of thing. I think I skipped over some of my note cards here with my talking. All of the war bonds, that was a fun one. They used to have Hollywood stars and starlets come here to sell war bonds. And they weren't major stars, they were, you know, people that had been in the movies. And they would come and make talks and then buy war bonds, and you could buy war stamps. Bonds. And then they got the idea of having these starlets come, and they would hike up their skirt every time somebody did a little bit more to buy a bigger bond. And they called them leg shows. And they had those. Terry's mom, meanwhile, was down working at Evans Products Company, which is down where Fred Meyer is now. Partly Safeway, but mostly Fred Meyer. And they made battery separators, which kept the acid on this side of the battery from getting over where it didn't belong on the other side of the battery. They were made out of pour over from cedar, which was the best wood for that purpose that grew here. And so they were making most of the battery separators that were used anywhere in the world before and after the war and during it were made right here. Coos and Banks, meanwhile, was making that minesweeper you saw in the first slide I had up there. And the reason they made minesweepers here was because they wanted them to be made out of wood. Because a lot of the mines are detect metal, and that's what makes them blow up. Whereas if you got a wooden vessel, the only metal is the engine. It didn't seem to set off these mines, and the North End Airport was all going with all its runways and Quonset huts and barracks and things over there. There, some of them still there and still in use. Talked about the planes. Oh. Meanwhile, back here in the United States, there was an event that happened, I think it was late 1939, early 1940, where a bunch of scientists had been driven out of Germany, the Netherlands, Belgium, a lot of them Jewish men, who who came over here, and they knew about atoms. And they believed that you could create a bomb out of otherwise pretty mild stuff like uranium and plutonium. And they tried to get military and president involved in this, and they would, I don't know what you're talking about then. And then they went and got Einstein to write a letter to President Roosevelt that said, hey, this is real stuff. You should be listening to these people, because they can make a very destructive bomb like the world has never seen. And I don't like the idea that they might do it, but if somebody's going to do it, it damn well better be us. He didn't quite say it that way, but that was his point. And so Roosevelt commissioned this thing that they called the Manhattan Project. And that was this collection of scientists, and they had a thing in the University of Chicago, and that was the first place they had a sustained chain nuclear reaction. And they did it by putting these uranium things in there, and they got enough of them in a great big pile of graphite blocks. And they'd stick in another piece of uranium, a little thing of it, and another one, and all of a sudden this rocket went click, 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 you know, and it was reacting. And they realized that you could have a sustained reaction. And they quickly pulled some of the stuff out before it got too excited. Let's see. Meanwhile, people in combat, my brother, my uncle George was in New Guinea. He was a cook, but that also meant he was the machine gunner for his unit. He fought Japanese with a machine gun. My uncle Richard Minot was involved in the invasion of some of the ports in Italy. My uncle Richard, when he was on a little vessel, I think it was a minesweeper or something, called the Sparrow, and the Sparrow got hit by a kamikaze plane. And Joe McEwen's father was also on a vessel that was hit by a kamikaze plane, the last one to be hit. I think it was the Ticonderoga he was on. We recaptured all these islands that the Japanese had taken from us. And then in July of 1945, I should talk a little bit about the bombing campaign. The Americans and British kept building up more and more and more planes, and they soon were able to send these 1,000 plane raids from here in England over to various places in Germany and some in France, where there were Germans building armaments and so on. And they'd have 1,000 planes at night, and then after that was over, the Americans would come with 1,000 planes in the daytime, and the British had 1,000 of them at night. And they were better suited for night flying than the Americans were. And the Americans had a flying fortress, which was more heavily armored and could fight off fighter planes better. And that was going on. Americans captured Okinawa. In April of 45, the Russians took Berlin, and Hitler committed suicide, killed his wife, Eva Braun, here in Berlin, and then shot himself. And that was basically the end of the war in Europe. But the war with Japan was still going on, we were bombing Japanese cities, and we had a B-29 by that time, great big plane, not so big by today's standards, but big by those standards. And they would fly it over and drop bombs on all the Japanese cities, which were largely made out of bamboo and paper. A lot of the houses, you know, they'd catch fire, the whole thing would burn up. And then they tested the first atom bomb in Nevada, New Mexico area. I should know that, but I don't remember right now.
Trinity site. near Alamogordo, New Mexico.
Yeah, thank you. And there was a uranium bomb, which was smaller in girth than the plutonium bomb, but roughly the same size. And it went off whoop-de-doo, you know, and people had to shield their eyes to keep from losing their sight and stuff like that, and it worked. So they took him over to, to an island in the Pacific where they had long runways. They put one of them in one of their B-29s and flew over Hiroshima and dropped the bomb and killed a whole gob of people, thousands, tens of thousands of people. And the Japanese didn't quite know what happened, but they knew it was not very good. And there was a pretty strong peace movement in Japan then to try and end the war, surrender. And the military part of things, side of things, wouldn't agree to that. They wanted to keep fighting. And it became obvious they weren't going to surrender, even after Hiroshima. So the Allies then dropped the bomb on Nagasaki. And after that, they could see they had no way. There was going to be the end of Japan. They didn't. So they did then surrender. And that was how World War II ended here. A lot of servicemen came back here. They would buy military surplus vehicles, trucks, jeeps, and things, and they would start the logging operations. My Uncle George and my Uncle William Bauer had a thing called Whitty Bauer Lumber Company, and it consisted of several trucks with a big saw on one of them, and they'd go out in the woods and fall trees and drag them in there with a little caterpillar, cut them up right out there, make piles of lumber, pile the lumber on another truck, and away it would go. And there were all kinds of them. They called them Jippo sawmills. And there were, I think, a couple hundred of them around here. They were all over because there was great demand for wood. Nobody had been able to build anything all through during the war, you know. And so, anyway, I think I should stop now because the war is over. And you guys can ask questions if you want. I'd be glad to answer. Anybody got a question?
Because you were so
yes.
What else did we make here?
We made an awful lot of lumber that was used to build barracks and things like that. They were still running the mills that they could run with, but they had a lot more women working in mills, and older people that had thought they'd retired would go back to work, partly because it was pretty good jobs, paid well, and because the military needed it. There was great feelings of helping the troops, because you all had family that were over there, you know, and you wanted them to be able to have what they needed to fight with. I don't remember. There was a chrome plant between Coos Bay and Coquille, right where the North Bank Road takes off at 42. And none of us ever really understood how the chrome fit into the war, but it was there during the war, and after the war it went away. So I don't know. Somehow they used it to make maybe armored steel. I don't know. There was something, the chrome added to the manufacturing process that they wanted, and we haven't here. Yes, ma'am.
When you were a paper boy and you had that extra edition.
Oh yeah, I'll tell about that. On D-Day, my brothers and I, we delivered every paper that was around. We would deliver the Oregonian and the Oregon Journal, which both of which then sold papers down here, and the Coos Bay Times, which was an afternoon paper. And we never delivered more than one route at a time. We had the Oregonian, we didn't do the afternoon one too, but we always had a paper route. And this one morning, I think we were delivering the Journal then, and we used to get all the papers from Portland delivered down at the Tioga Hotel on the exit, the entry exit on Broadway. And frequently there would be a drunk man laying there sleeping, and we never felt quite comfortable with that. That was where they put the papers, so we had to go get them. We're down there getting the papers, and here comes the guy from the Coos Times. "Boys, boys, we've invaded Europe. We got an extra coming out. If you guys will sell the extra, you can sell for 25 cents, and you can keep 10 cents for each paper." Well, that was big money, I'll tell you. Normally, if you sold a copy of the Coos Times, you sold it for a nickel, and you got to keep 2.5 cents. But that was a really good deal. So I take off with my little pile of journal papers in my bag, and I'm carrying these extras. And we used to read Captain Marvel and Superman and things like that. And frequently when Superman would do something great, they'd have the paper boy standing on the corner with his, and he wouldn't holler, "Extra, extra," read all about it. He would holler, "Wuxtry, W-U-X-T-R-Y. Where that came from, none of us ever knew. That was when all the cartoons that showed "Wuxtry, Wuxtry." So we went around town hollering, "Wuxtry, Wuxtry," and worked pretty well. And I still remember there was a man in the house, the man in the house right behind where the McKay's Fresh Mart is there on Central, right behind that. And I was going up Anderson Avenue hollering away, and this man rolls up his window and he says, "What are you hollering about, kid?" I said, "Oh, Allies invade Europe. It's D-Day." And I didn't know what it was. I said that on the headline. So, and he says, "You give me one of those." He went and got a dollar bill and gave it to me. He says, "You just keep that," he said. So I made 75 cents. Anyway.
Yes, sir. Was the airport here, or did the government build it during the war?
Government built it during the war. There was an airport. There were two airports. There was one right over here in Eastside, which was the more popular of the two airports for these little Piper Cubs and planes like that. And I think it was possibly because the wind wasn't quite as strong there as it is out over there. But the Navy people couldn't fit their thing in there, so they built it out there, and it didn't take them very long. I think it was going by mid-1942, maybe even a little earlier. And that's why we have that nice airport now. Other, yes?
You may want to comment on those that served on a voluntary basis here locally to observe any airports.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we had coast watchers who would sit there and wait for the Japanese planes. We never expected German planes, Japanese planes, to come flying over, and then they could call and warn everybody. But none ever came that I know about. They used to have big dirigibles, blimps, that would fly out over the ocean. And those were fun to watch. They were fair-sized things, and they would look for submarines. Yes, Andy?
John, before the war, there's the Japs that come over, get lumber, but they had all of their crews going all through the neighborhoods taking pictures. I can remember in 38, 39, you'd see these Japs come around with their little cameras and taking pictures, and I assumed that they were the target.
Could have been. They didn't know they were doing that. Definitely doing that in Hawaii, all over around Honolulu. They were doing that, taking pictures. And they also, we used to sell scrap metal right here to Japanese freighters that were then carted back to Japan. That continued until July of 1940, when President Roosevelt said, "No more of that. We're not selling those people anymore." Yeah.
We have parachute bombs that came over here.
Well, they were balloon bombs. Yeah. And they were built by schoolgirls in Japan. There was a young Japanese, partly Japanese woman who came here and presented a program at the Egyptian Theater and showed the movie of them making those things and some of them flying, and they were didn't have helium in them, I don't think. I think they were fueled by hot air from a fire. When the fire would go out, the thing would settle. But by that time, it had flown clear across the Pacific because they would release them at a time when the winds were blowing favorably to make that happen. And there was one of those, and only one that I know of, that actually killed some people. And it landed by Merlin, which I think is over by Klamath Falls. And this church group went up.
Outside of Grants Pass.
Anyway, this church group went up just to, after the service, kids, they're running around out in the hills. They spot this thing and they run and get the teacher and go up there, and somebody touches the wrong thing and it blows up and kills about 8 or 9 of the kids, and the adult died. But that was the only one I ever heard of where they successfully got anybody, and then it was people who were not involved in the war effort.
John,
yeah.
That DVD is called On Paper Wings, and yes. You can get it at the library, through the library.
Yeah.
And we have remnants of one from here.
We do? Well, good.
Okay.
I guess that's it. Thank you for coming.